Wonderful man.
Death is very sad. I really haven't time.
Oh, it won't take any time at all if you have your refreshments while we conduct our business.
Tea will be fine.
I'll pour, Albert.
Yes, Miss Merrifield.
I ordered tea brewed because I was expecting Mr. Hollander, avid tea drinker. But I suppose reading of a will is usually left to the junior partner. Will you have cream, Mr. Bentley, or brandy? Brandy lends an elegance to tea.
Neither, thank you, and no sugar. Mm-hmm. The actual reading is a formality we can dispense with, and I can give you the salient points. After all, you're the only person mentioned in the will.
Oh, well, I shouldn't be surprised to find that Joseph had left me everything. After all, there's no one else he could have possibly included. Will you have a piece of hazelnut cake?
No, thank you.
Of course, I'll depend on you to fill me in the details of Joseph's enterprises. I suppose they're terribly involved.
Actually, not that much. To sum up, Mrs. Marrable, your husband was not as solvent as you probably assume.
Oh, you must be referring to that dilapidated apartment house he bought. Joseph mentioned that that turned out to be an unprofitable purchase.
Yes, he disposed of that some time ago.
Oh, did he? Well, he wasn't always able to keep me up on all his ventures. His oil holdings, though, must be doing very well.
His oil holdings are unexercised options.
They must have some value. Well, Joseph invested in so many companies. They're so numerous, I can't even remember all the names.
Mrs. Marrable, there are no assets, only liabilities. Surely you know your husband borrowed the money to pay the surgeon for the last two operations, and the hospital bill has yet to be settled.
You are overlooking the insurance, which amounted to $200,000 before he increased it.
He cashed out all his policies.
Well, certainly there's the house. With the furniture and the rugs. How many of these pieces have been in Joseph's family for generations? They don't belong to me either.
I'm afraid not. I have the documents here. Of course, Mr. Marrable bequeathed his personal possessions to you, including his watch, his gold cufflinks, his briefcase with all its contents.
He lost his cufflinks. The watch disappeared between trips to the hospital. have his rusty dagger. His stamp album that he hasn't looked at in years. And his boyhood butterfly collection. All this is mine, is it? To keep. Plus the shirt on my back, I suppose. What am I going to do?
You must have relatives.
No, I have a nephew in Arizona or is in New Mexico, but I haven't laid eyes on him since he was a child. I have no one.
I'm sorry, but I'll need your signature on these.
Nothing, nothing. Mr. Bentley, all I have left is my personal savings account.
That ought to help.
To live on for the rest of my life.
Well, it's something to keep you going for a while.
It won't last any time at all, and you know that, and Joseph Mirabel knew that. How am I to live?
I'll need your signature.
What am I going to live on? What should I do? What should I do?
Your signature, Mrs. Mirabel?
Do it now.
Oh, yes. Soil's too dry in the daytime. And the hot sun can burn the roots. Pick that up, will you?
Thank you. you fetch the mail?
Is that sample of tea you sent for? Want it for your lunch?
Oh, there'll be plenty of time to taste it. Just store it for the present. Naturally, without opening the lid. Hindus have taken great pains to teach us that tea loses its aroma unless properly sealed. I have been invited to join the museum building committee.
Lunch is almost ready.
I have to talk to Juan first.
Has he made one of his usual blunders? I'll never know why you put up with it.
Miss Tinsley. Miss Tinsley! Oh, do remember to leave ample room for the roots. My gardening magazine says it never hurts to make the hole too deep.
I make it good. But when they bring the tree, huh?
Oh, the nursery delivers in the late afternoon, but as you know, I like to attend to it myself.
You have a very green thumb. Yes. Your pine trees grow good. Very good.
Don't spill it. Obviously, you haven't the remotest idea how much a bottle of Grand Marnier is worth, or you'd be more watchful of every drop. You've never tasted it, have you?
No. I'm afraid I don't care for liquor.
When referring to a cordial, we use the French pronunciation. Liqueur, Miss Tinsley. I shouldn't try to teach you any more, considering how little you've absorbed under my tutelage. Will you turn that off, please?
It's one of your favorites.
Is it? Indeed. I believe we can do without music this evening.
May I see the financial page?
You may. What you expect to find there, your stocks are unlisted as they were the day you placed your order.
But how are they doing? Are they going up or are they going down?
How would I know?
Well, I thought your broker would keep you advised.
He has more pressing business than to render daily quotations of your gigantic investment.
I know it doesn't seem much to you, but it represents my savings, practically all of it.
It was at your request, my dear Miss Tinsley, that I handed your massive capital over to my broker.
Well, yes. When you told me your stock had doubled and was still going up, I...
You wanted to hitch onto a star without any awareness of how treacherously it can become a falling comet. However, no more of this. I'll call my broker in the morning and instruct him to sell your securities at a loss, if need be.
Oh, no. I can't afford that. I don't want to sell now. Don't call him, Mrs. Marrable, not on my account, please.
I won't, if you'll kindly stop wringing your hands over your money.
I think I'll go to my room. Good night.
Miss Tinsley, you promised to help me plant my pine tree.
You want to do it now?
Go on, I'll join you in the garden in a moment.
Much easier in the light of day.
Well, the soil's too dry in the daytime. Besides, hot sun can burn the roots.
I think this hole's too big for that little tree.
Oh, I don't think so. Oh, what a nuisance. My watch dropped off.
I don't see it.
It's over there. Down there.
Charming the men.
Who wouldn't with that fabulous necklace that you and George gave her?
I wouldn't have my own mother to a cocktail party.
Elva, George and I are very fond of Aunt Claire.
We know, dear. That's why you asked her to come and live in Arizona.
She's got so much money that somebody has to keep a watchful eye over her.
You aid and abet them.
Well, Aunt Claire believes in the underdog, don't you, Aunt Claire?
Wait till the underdog starts building across the road from you.
If the Indians are rich enough to build there, George won't mind a bit. That's the measure of aristocracy nowadays, isn't it?
George? It isn't every day I can get away from my dull husband for a matinee. I went there, my darling. I waited over half an hour. You should never miss an appointment with me because, you see, I give no second chance. Pity, too.
You've escaped. What's wrong with our party?
Well, nothing. It's lovely. Maybe I've been to too many in the East. And this is the reason I came to Arizona.
The rocks or the snakes?
The open spaces.
No kidding. Well, there's a lot more desert out there. Let me take you for a drive. They won't miss us. Least of all my wife.
No, thank you. I'd like to take my time discovering the desert.
I confess that's what I had in mind.
On my own.
Well, your brother-in-law asked us to look out for you.
He went too far. The whole family did.
Well, they wanted to be nice to the widow.
And so do you.
Harriet, I'm sorry your husband was killed. Let's go, huh?
Well, well, well. Mrs. Vaughn, I don't believe you've met George's aunt, Mrs. Marrable.
Mrs. Vaughn's brother-in-law is a stockbroker, too, in the East.
I hope he gives better advice than George.
Both stocks I bought for you went up, Aunt Claire.
Up and down, never enough to matter.
I should be going. It's nice to meet you, Mrs. Marrable.
I'd completely forgotten you had a child to take care of. I'm so glad you had time for a breather.
Bye-bye.
Can I get you another drink, Aunt Claire?
Oh, enough. To steer this vehicle of mine.
I hope you find a new housekeeper soon. It's a pity you had to fire Miss Tinsley.
She was the nicest one you ever had. You know, I still can't picture her drunk.
Oh, she was, though, horribly. Otherwise, I wouldn't have discharged her.
The help problem is getting absolutely impossible. I hope you didn't give Miss Tinsley any references.
She knew better than to ask for them.
You've had such rotten luck with your housekeepers, Aunt Claire.
Have I? Actually, I think I've done rather well. Makes this valley so Republican popular.
Prettiest part of the county, but it is kind of remote.
Well, there's one neighbor.
No one's lived there for some time now.
I gave up nursing and marrying a doctor, but when he left me by dying, a few years ago, I took it up again. Of course, my knowledge was pretty dated to return to full-fledged nursing, so I became a sort of a combination housekeeper-nurse companion.
Have you any references?
Three. I had four positions, but one of my people died. Quiet, natural death at age 95, and I haven't been able to reach his son.
You mustn't be misled by my confinement to this chair. It's purely temporary, and I shan't require any nursing, however adept you may be in that field.
Well, you don't object to it as a bonus, I hope. I can cook a grand meal, everything from buttermilk pancakes to a very good boeuf bourguignon. I've always kept a neat house.
I assume there's an underlying reason for your desire to offer your services. What is it?
In other words, why do I want to work? Well, I apply for the job, so I guess I want it. Do you require better reasons than that?
My dear woman, you don't expect me to buy a pig in a poke, do you?
I want to work because I don't think anyone should be idle. It's bad for your morale. Besides, I don't like to live by myself. I can't come up with more reasons, but I'll keep trying. I know it isn't easy to pick one out of all the people who answer your ad.
Well, I assure you that not every applicant who contacts me by phone is invited to appear in person. Should I, however, decide on you, the terms must be quite clear. I provide room and board, and the stipend indicated in my advertisement, there are to be no increases.
Well, the salary's very satisfactory. I wouldn't have come out here.
We wouldn't allow you to save much, and I would like to know that you're covered in case of illness.
Hmm? Oh, I do have savings of my own.
You don't drink, do you? Why are you hesitating?
Well, I'd hate to miss out on the job because I enjoy an occasional glass of sherry.
One more thing. I've had abominable luck with housekeepers who went dashing off to family weddings and to nurse ailing grandchildren.
But who would I dash off to? I've nobody. Nobody in the entire world.
Mrs. Dimmick, I hope you will be very happy here.
Before you leave, would you transplant the geranium?
I don't consider that broad-minded.
Well, I think you're a saint. Stuck with that brat for months. How can you stand it? Don't you think your husband's family took advantage of you?
Nope. I volunteered. Gave me a chance to get away from the relatives, both Ken's and mine. And from the small talk, gossip, pressures.
To become one with nature.
Maybe.
Does that apply to men, too? I'm sorry. I suppose it's too soon.
Don't be sorry. It's a good question. I just don't have the answer.
Well, you couldn't have come to a better place if you want a good roll in the hay. Help yourself. Even with George.
No, thank you.
I think you're the kind that plays for keeps. If that's
your... Excuse me. Mrs. Lawson.
Yes.
I knew I couldn't be wrong, but I can't pinpoint where we met.
Maybe we haven't.
We must have. I knew your name. Mine's Mike Dare. Mind if I sit down?
Please. You don't mind.
No?
Have you also met Mrs. Vaughn somewhere?
No, I haven't.
You don't live in Tucson?
No, I'm from Phoenix. I'm only here for the day to see a customer.
Let's see who can tell what Mr. Dare sells. I say real estate.
Your guess.
Mrs. Vaughn doesn't play games. So says my husband.
Some games I do. I don't know what you sell, but some of your work is done with your hands.
Hey, you're warm. I take your ordinary automobile and I turn it into a snappy racing car. You go to the racetrack?
Yeah.
She's here taking care of a sick nephew. The poor little thing has asthma and takes up all of her time.
He is improving.
But you told me he was...
Well, no boy of 10 years old likes to be cooped up in a hotel. Especially when he's been promised a great adventure in the West.
Look, I know this isn't exactly typical of the West, but I bet he likes fast cars.
Well, he wouldn't be the only one. I'd love to see what a souped-up motor would do for my car.
I'll be glad to demonstrate.
Well, it's been very nice seeing you again. Please call
us. I will.
Let me take care of the check.
Well, thank you.
I'll call you the next time I'm in the village.
Oh?
To demonstrate my engine.
Well, bye, you two.
What's the matter?
I was ready to laugh.
Why don't you pour yourself one, too?
May I?
Please do. Lovely. Mrs. Timmick, take a look at my calendar. What do I have to do this afternoon?
You have a note here I can't make out.
Oh, I have to write to my broker in Chicago. He's a marvelous man, the old school. He's not much given to correspondence, but he has yet to be wrong about a stock.
But, your nephew is a stockbroker?
Oh, nothing like my man in Chicago. He's a delight. He's made a fortune for me. You wouldn't know the word for parrot fever.
Psittacosis.
Oh, Mrs. Timmick. How marvelous to have an encyclopedic knowledge. You wouldn't know how to spell it, would you?
P-S-I-T-T-A...
Dog is... Chloe, get away from there.
Don't you hurt that dog!
Who are you?
James Vaughn, and where's your property law?
Jim! Oh, I'm awfully sorry. Jim's been reading about all the land the Indians had, and he... We moved into the cottage for 3 months. I don't think you remember me. We met at the Lawsons. My name is Harriet Vaughn.
I was not informed that the cottage was available for renting.
Ask her if Chloe belongs to her.
Chloe?
Well, that's what she called the dog.
Chloe is a tramp.
Then we can keep her, Harriet.
You will do nothing of the kind. And if the dog is so misfortunate as to appear again, you will not encourage her to stay.
I hope that wasn't an order, Mrs. Marrable. If you don't want the dog around, we'll work it out. But
I have not taken loving and diligent care of my garden to have it wrecked by this vagrant bitch.
Neighbors don't always warm up to each other right away. Mrs. Marrable hasn't had any for years.
Can we keep the dog?
We'll keep the dog out of this garden or we'll have the sheriff after us.
He doesn't even know what kind of dog it is. You know, male or female.
Rose Hall was forever petting and feeding Chloe.
Rose
Hall, she used to live in that cottage before she became my housekeeper.
What's the wonder she didn't take a dog with?
It wasn't her dog. I have told you, Chloe is a tramp. At least she was clever enough not to come around after Rose Hall left.
Well, did Rose Hall...
George, someone has moved into the cottage.
Well, you had a chance to buy that cottage when Rose Hall stopped making payments. The bank owns it now.
Well, I had no idea anyone would want to live there. I must have my privacy, George. Use your friends at the bank, can't you? Didn't you tell me you're one big club, one for all and all for nobody?
Explain myself. I'm entering the same contest as Mrs. Marrable. I can't let her know. She wouldn't like that at all. So I was mailing my card from your box. A blank card is all that they ask for. The first 100 entries get a portable makeup mirror that lights up all over.
How will they know where to send it? There's no return address.
Oh, am I getting absent-minded? Oh, yeah.
Mrs. Dimmick, may I have my mail, please? That is, unless our captivating neighbor requires you further.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize you were up and about. She seems to be a pleasant young lady.
Would you prefer to be in her employ?
I was just being friendly, that's all.
Oh, I'm convinced of it. Soap manufacturers put more scent in their samples than they do in the product they sell. Put that in the closet, will you?
Well, we have so much stored up in there, we can open up shop.
Are you suggesting that I give it away to your newly acquired friend across the way? I won! I won! I am the winner of the, oh, well, it's only the third prize. Nevertheless, feast your eyes on that.
$25. What was the contest?
In 50 words or less, I gave an inspired account of how I allured my most recent boyfriend. I am going to proceed to enter every teenage contest in the country. I didn't expect...
Oh, I should have told the mailman there's no one here by that name.
Post offices have been known to make mistakes before. It's not a serious one. This was her address at one time.
Breakfast ready.
Thank you.
Another couple of months. We took a lease on the cottage. But you know that.
Are you happy with the place?
Uh-huh. Great for Jim. Me too. I'm so glad you told me about it.
I'm sure the lease can be extended.
Oh, I might stay longer. I just might.
Thank you.
aware that the cocktail hour has come and gone?
Has it? I have your margarita right here. I'm a bit slow today. Haven't had much experience with pheasant.
When I engaged you, you led me to assume that you were a highly proficient cook. I wouldn't be thrown off schedule by a new variety of fowl.
I'm only running a few minutes late.
Punctuality is essential to a gracious way of life, which I do not intend to give up on account of you.
Well, I've been trying to prepare a lovely meal. And that cannot be done with all the complaints and interruptions.
I warn you not to raise your voice.
I would like to be heard for once. If you want to live like some duchess, some maharani, you better learn to behave like one.
I might have known this would be my reward for being far more considerate and patient and generous to you than I have been to any of my former housekeepers.
And how long did they stay with you?
Not one of them walked out on me. Are you threatening to? Well, are you?
No, I wasn't threatening to walk out, no. I wouldn't blame you if you fired me on the spot.
Oh, well, I must admit that I was tempted to. But I soon realized that what at first seemed disrespect, if not mutiny, was simply an uncontrollable outburst of temper.
My temper will do me in. Oh, I've been told and told. If I keep on flying off the handle, I'll have no friends left.
Well, I've been so disgusted with the procession of humdrum, mealy-mouthed yes ladies who paraded through this house that a touch of fire is a welcome change.
I've been wondering about those others. We nurses tend to do that. If you learn where your predecessor fell short, you're less likely to make the same mistakes.
Well, there's no danger. Miss Tinsley was a tedious woman, endowed with an astonishing lack of taste.
Oh. Is that why you got rid of her?
No, it was her devotion to alcohol which brought about the parting of our ways.
You mean she drank a whole lot?
Oh, well, I wouldn't have made an issue of an occasional highball. Oh, what I had to go through to cleanse her room of that pervasive odor of gin. And once she stumbled into this table, knocking off all the china and the glassware, and then proceeded to put her fist through the window pane. Times like that, the filth that came out of her mouth. Why, worthy of a man who'd spent his entire life at sea. And undoubtedly, she learned it from just such men.
Men?
Oh, at her age, she was carrying on with strangers who would call in the middle of the night, write letters to her. I'd prefer to forget that she was ever here, my dear.
Well, you've said I had your share of strange experiences. Of course, hiring women from an ad could be a risky business. How do you make your choices?
Oh, well, I take into account their experience, their references.
It could be dangerous, though, living way out here in the desert. No protection to speak of.
Oh, I've never been afraid. Not of people.
My, hadn't that a knife?
You don't think it has a bitter taste?
Does it? Mmm. Well, I'm afraid so. Distinctly bitter flavor. Did you get this at the market?
Pheasant is hardly an item you'd expect to find on supermarket shelves. These birds were brought to me by George.
Oh.
What's the matter? Aren't you going to eat it at all?
Why not play it safe, Mrs. Marrable? I've seen enough in my years as a nurse to scare me, especially where there's money.
You didn't finish your sentence.
I've been taken off a case when the patient showed the first signs of improvement. Oh, doctor wanted me to stay on for a while, but not the family. When the patient died, you blame me for wondering if it wasn't a bit unnatural?
George and Julia. Oh, absurd notion. You are far too permissive with your fantasy. People don't go around murdering each other.
It may not be as difficult as you think.
It's not very perceptive of you to minimize the courage that it takes to kill.
Courage? Why, it's just nerve with a dash of cruelty.
Oh, you're mistaken. It takes extraordinary courage, born of inner fortitude. My father told me that, and he was an authority, having spent his life in the military establishment. It takes extraordinary courage.
Well, if you're not afraid, why don't you eat your pheasant?
I've lost my appetite, Mrs. Tibbett.
Sabre Industries.
This is Mrs. Claire Marrable calling from Tucson. I believe you wrote a letter of reference for Mrs. Dimmick, who is now in my employ. I would like to verify that she worked for you and that you found her satisfactory.
Sure, she worked for my mother for over 2 years. A wonderful woman. I'll tell you this, though, she's got an Irish temper, and if it shows up, you better watch out.
Thank you.
Sure, anytime, Mrs. Marrable. You're lucky to have her.
Goodbye.
You're shaking like a leaf. Take it easy, will you? The Queen of Spades won't be back for a while.
Oh, I don't like to take unnecessary chances.
You said they went out to dinner.
I didn't want you here today. I told you I'd stay in touch with you.
Well, I've had it with the blank postcards and this whole damn mystery bit. You're getting out of here and going home with me right now. You can't go on playing this part.
Oh, I haven't been found out yet, and I won't be if you don't give me away.
You don't have the strength.
Never felt stronger in my life.
Or the training.
You don't appreciate my talent. I have to stay here. Now, you're entitled to think that I'm playing with the squirrels. Don't ask me to leave. Just don't! Those blank postcards were your idea.
I had to know you were all right.
They're piling up too high for you. I'll stop sending them.
Let me take the statue, Aunt Claire.
You've got to stop blaming yourself for Miss Tinsley.
How can I? It was my fault. Of course I didn't mean the things I said, but say them I did. I'm not going to give up until I find out where she is. My instincts tell me something happened to her here.
You just can't jump to conclusions.
Not just the Bible. Mrs. Marrable's housekeeper seemed to vanish. And you haven't heard her talk about the courage to kill.
Let's get out of here.
Well, there's one thing that I want you to do for me.
Help you pack.
Go to the First National Bank in Phoenix, find out if Edna still has money in her savings account.
You just can't walk into a bank
You'll
and ask...
You'll find a way. Oh, please. Now, after that, I'll do whatever you say. I'll leave this house. Is that good enough? And I also want her forwarding address.
Wait a minute, my shoes.
Won't you come in for a drink?
Oh, well, thank you, Aunt Claire, but we should be going.
Oh, very well. And thank you for entertaining me so regularly. You call me before long?
We will.
Goodbye.
Forgot to say goodbye. Oh, you sure you wouldn't be interested in the polo match at the Bennett's on Saturday?
Aunt Claire doesn't like polo. You know that, George.
Well, thank you anyway, George.
Bye.
Yes.
I must have dozed off. You have a pleasant time at the fair?
Why did you let her pick the most expensive statue they had?
Oh, it's a good long-term investment, Julia.
Oh, yes, George, but are we so sure that Aunt Claire is a sound stock?
You mean because she never pays for anything when she's with us?
Mm.
She thinks we're loaded.
Well, we're so smart we fooled her, haven't we? But she might be playing the same game.
We can give you the information, Mr. Darrah. Miss Edna Tinsley's current balance is $32.83.
She withdrew $9,000 on March 5th?
Yes, she took out the entire amount in cash.
You have her latest boarding address?
Yeah, it's right here on the card. Care of Marable, Route 3, Tucson.
Thank you.
Right.
Oh, yes. Mrs. Marable is terribly rich. However, I doubt that auto races will appeal to Aunt Claire, but she'll take to you.
Well, if all the proceeds are going to her Indian charity, she ought to go for it.
Even if she doesn't, I'm enchanted that you called me.
Hey, Harriet. Come here. Come here. Look over there.
That's remarkably magnanimous of you, Mr. Darrah.
If I could use your phone, Mrs. Marable, I could call the manager of the racetrack and check on available dates right now.
Oh, please do. Mrs. Dimmick.
Yes?
Thank you.
Mrs. Dimmick, my housekeeper will show you the phone. Mrs. Dimmick, this is Mr. Darrah. He would like to make a phone call.
Certainly. This way, please, Mr. I didn't catch the name.
Darrah.
How is it that you've never introduced me to Mr. Darrah before?
Well, we've only met recently. Actually, George hasn't even met him yet.
Ah. Would you tell dear George to call me this evening, Julia?
Certainly.
Must talk to him about those stocks, which do nothing but go down.
Mr. Johnson, please.
They've both been dropping points every day, causing me great concern.
Well,
yeah,
that's just what George.
Back up, Aunt Alice. I mean it. You're going back to Phoenix with me now.
Sometimes dip.
You promised if you got this information.
Stop whispering.
What are you going to do exactly?
George must have had some inside tip on those stocks, I'm sure. Stocks do go up and down so rapidly sometimes.
Well, that's the market for you, Aunt Claire.
I told George to sell before I took a loss. He procrastinated until it was too late.
You're leaving with me.
I'll meet you at the market on Route 4, 9 tomorrow morning.
You better not let me down, Aunt Alice. I mean it.
Yeah, I see. No, that's all right. I'll call back. Yeah, thank you.
I mean it.
Would you?
would you pour?
Love to.
And it's better to perish than fail to maintain appearances. That's a trait George inherited from his grandfather, my father. Very few of us understood Papa. He was a gentleman of style, of true style.
That's the word that I've been trying to think of, style. That's what you have, Mrs. Marrable, style.
I thank you. I should hope so.
And a flair for things. I wish I had. I wish I had your flair for money.
I don't believe I ever heard you mention money before. It's hardly a flair, dear Mrs. Dimmick.
I'm not a greedy woman, but it irks me to see how little my money earns in the bank. When you talk about your stocks, they sound fabulous.
Yes, all except those George recommends.
Don't you have a stockbroker in Chicago, too?
Yes.
Would you be willing to speak to him about me? I'd like to invest my money, and I need good advice.
And you shall have it. The stock market is one thing if you can stand the loss without being hurt. But if it's your life savings you're speculating with, don't dream of doing anything so foolish.
I wouldn't have the nerve to bother you if I wanted to invest a mere dribble. Now, this won't sound like much to you, but I've amassed a goodly sum.
Oh, have you? How much, Mrs. Dimmick?
Well, $46,000.
Admit, in my wildest dreams, I never thought such an amount could be accumulated by serving as a housekeeper or even a companion.
My husband left a generous insurance policy.
Even so, $46,000 could provide a handsome livelihood for a woman for quite a few years. You're extremely fortunate.
Now, will you speak to your broker?
Oh, we'll see. We'll see. You have to let me sleep and think on it. May I have another cup?
Get out of my garden! Get out of my garden, you...
Hurry up! Hurry up! Hurry up! Hurry!
You get that dog out of my garden at once.
What happened?
Oh, I'm awfully sorry.
You deliberately enticed that dog here to destroy my ground.
It's impossible to keep him out of your garden. Maybe if we put up a small fence.
Are you taking it upon yourself to tell me what to do with my property?
I was suggesting a way to protect your garden.
You've had no compunction about taking the time of my companion, poking into my affairs, and overtly displaying your hatred of me. What do you want from me, Mrs. Vaughn?
I don't want anything from you.
You really expect me to believe that?
Please go back to the cottage.
Seems I'm powerless.
Oh, I wouldn't let her upset me.
She's like crabgrass, never really quelled, only cropping up secretly and victoriously in another spot. Well, but I do not intend to sit here and wait while she thinks up a new way to harass me. I won't have to. We will go to the Indian Music Festival in Tortugas. It's only a day's drive, and I've been wanting to hear their chants and see their dancing. We leave first thing in the morning. Dimmick.
Oh.
You don't dislike traveling, I trust.
No. If I'd known, I'd have bought stockings in town this morning. These are gone. They're my last pair. And I'm out of toothpaste. I know you don't like to lend yours.
I want to leave first thing in the morning, Mrs. Dimmick, without delay.
Do you mind if I drive into town now?
The new market has both nylons and toothpaste.
Oh, very well. You may take the car and get a road map at the service station, would you? Don't be too long.
Get it.
Hi.
We saw you with that other broad.
There he is. You've got the wrong idea. If you just let me tell you something.
Are you gonna let him? After what he did to you?
Shut up, Jim. Look, we can't talk here. Come with me. All you have to do is listen.
All right. But I hope you have something to say.
I found everything I needed. Would you like to study the road map?
Thank you.
I think I ought to start dinner.
Let's have a very light supper this evening, since we want to retire at an early hour. Mrs. Dimmick, would you write a letter to Juan, reminding him to cover the roses with burlap?
Well, I certainly will.
Will you do it now, please? It's the kind of last-minute detail we might overlook. Oh, I forgot. Juan's taking a week's vacation. It'll be his helper who attends my garden. What is his name? Alfredo? Alberto? You'd better just put Al, and then we'll be correct in any case. I'll take care of it. Just leave it on the table. turn that off, will you? I think we can do without music tonight.
Will you have your liqueur?
Is there any particular reason why I shouldn't? Did I tell you to help yourself?
Well, I'm very sorry.
I hate the sticky bottle.
I told you I made a promise. I'll tell you the whole story tomorrow, and you'll see it's got nothing to do with you and me. Vow of silence again?
Suppose I have nothing to say.
Well, I said something. Did you hear me? I said I love you.
I didn't ask for that.
I know you didn't. But I know if I lie, I'll lose you. I don't want to lose you, Harriet. Believe me now?
I'm not sure, but I don't want to go home.
Mrs. Dimmick, I'm going to leave the note for the gardener. Please forgive me for not knocking. I forgot my manners and my anxiety to see that every window in the house is tightly closed. If it should rain, my floors would turn into soaking sponges.
Yes. Oh, the weather report is ghastly. High winds, terrible drop in temperature. We may have to postpone our trip.
Oh, the sun will be shining for us when we get to New Mexico, I promise you. Have a good sleep, Mrs. Dimmick.
Thank you.
It's a coincidence, isn't it? I couldn't sleep either.
Oh, yes. I never can sleep through the night before a trip. I guess it's because I haven't traveled much.
Sleeplessness can be brought on by any number of apprehensions. In your case, I dare say even I can diagnose the cause. You've been too preoccupied about your money.
Oh, no, it's the last thing on my mind.
I think I'll have some hot milk. Perhaps it will help me sleep. When I turned on the light, you were on the verge of making a phone call.
Oh, yes. I was checking the Weather Bureau.
I thought you might be calling the market to order new toothpaste and stockings. What a fraud you are! You come into my house in the guise of a faithful companion. You want to utterly destroy me.
I didn't come here to destroy you.
You did, however, lie.
So did you. Edna never left this house, did she?
What was Edna Tinsley to you?
For many, many years, she lived in my house. We ate together and shopped and traveled. She was my companion.
Do you expect me to believe that...
I don't care what you believe. I shared bread with my companion, not crumbs. I never humiliated her.
She left your service?
Yes, she did, and that was my doing. But she was ready to come back to me. She told me so over the phone. Her voice shaking, she was so frightened of you. Where is she?
When you left the house this afternoon, you went to meet someone, didn't you? That girl across the way.
How many women have you killed?
Now, you could have lasted quite a few years.
Do you expect me to be flattered?
I expected a little loyalty. It isn't often that I find someone whose company I enjoy, truly enjoy. I saw many happy years ahead for both of us. You are the only mistake I made.
Didn't you ever think you'd be found out?
No, and I won't be.
You've given yourself away.
To you, you are a dead woman.
Oh, no, I'm alive. See, I'm very much alive. And I'm not gonna be your next victim!
dead all
Your nephew called a few minutes ago. Your phone hasn't been answering and he's concerned.
Oh, won't you please come in? I'm so sorry I kept you waiting in that awful wind. Would you call George and assure him that we have survived the storm? Of course, poor Mrs. Dimmick went out early this morning in spite of all my warnings and received a terrible blow from a tree branch.
Oh.
Oh, but you excuse me a moment. You go ahead. Help yourself.
No, thank you.
Mrs. Dimmick, I wish you wouldn't try to get up. At least not yet. I do insist that you continue resting. She wants to drive into town to get my sinus prescription filled. It's a touching gesture, I must say, but of course I shan't allow her to do it.
Well, maybe I could.
Oh, I wouldn't think of it, Mrs. Vaughn. My sinus isn't that serious.
Oh, well, maybe I can get Mrs. Dimmick a doctor.
Oh, she's recovering very nicely. However, if you could report my phone, we'd be able to communicate with the outside world again.
I'd be glad to.
Well, thank you so very much, Mrs. Vaughn. We will pretend that you are loyal to the bitter end, running off to fill my prescription, no matter what the weather, or your own health.
How is Mrs. Marrable?
Fine, except for a sinus headache.
Sinus headache, I'll tell him. I imagine we'll be out to see her after a while.
All right, then. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Hey, Harriet. I thought you said Mrs. Dimmick was sick or something. Come here, look at her.
I'm surprised she got her way.
I told her.
Did you tell her? Who? Was it the girl across the road, your friend? Who? Tell me this instant. Tell me who.
Answering the door.
I don't know, Mike. Mrs. Dimmick went off in the car.
How long ago?
About a couple of hours.
You live here?
No, my aunt does.
Well, I hope you've got a key because no one's opening the door.
Out of order and have to check it.
Oh. Oh. Yes, of course. Please come in. Where's Mrs.
Isn't she here?
Oh. She must have gone to the drugstore after all. You know, nothing would satisfy Mrs. Dimmick, but she had to fetch my medicine. And I took two pills that she... Oh. Quite potent. I still feel rather groggy. Oh. Mr. Darrow, how nice to see you again. And won't you come in too, Mrs. Vaughn? You haven't seen Mrs. Dimmick, have you?
I saw her drive away a while ago. Isn't she back yet?
It seems she's not.
Phone's working fine. By the way, there's a call for you, Mrs. Maribel.
Oh, would you get it, George?
What drugstore did she usually go to?
I don't know. Why?
Thought we might call and find out if she'd been there or when she left.
Aunt Claire?
I'm afraid this is going to come as quite a shock to you. Mrs. Dimmick was found in your car. It went off the dirt road into the lake.
Yes. And Mrs. Dimmick?
Well, I'm afraid she's dead.
Michael, was she? I trust you. Why can't you trust me?
You said she was hurt.
Yes, by a branch. Mrs. Marival said she was...
Are you quoting me, Mrs. Vaughn?
I'm sorry.
She shouldn't have been driving if she felt sick.
Is the car wrecked?
Oh, Julia.
Well, it's not unfeeling to be practical. Why was she so eager to drive off this morning?
Well, if I were you, Aunt Claire, I'd check and see if everything's all right. I don't understand you people. You blame her, you suspect her, and no one has a kind word to say.
Fate has dealt me a cruel enough blow without your compounding it.
I don't understand you either, Mrs. Marival. Nobody seems to care.
Well, I care.
Mike, who was she?
I've got to go to town. I'll be back.
Mrs. Vaughn?
Yes?
This is your very distressed neighbor. I'm dreadfully lonely. Will you and James join me for cocktails? I'll have something different for him, of course.
I'm afraid I have some errands.
I would be ever so grateful if you would come to see me this afternoon. Won't you please?
Well, I don't...
Please.
All right, I'll come.
Wonderful. Oh, wonderful. Will 5:30 suit you?
Fine. When are you going to talk to Mrs. Marival?
Why are you picking on her? You're not from around here. You don't know her like we do.
Is she above suspicion, Sheriff?
You're crazy.
You sure that eggnog is all right?
Oh, yes, it's fine.
You know, Mrs. Dimmick and I used to sit here every evening before dinner. I'm sure we shall both miss her. Isn't that true, Mrs. Vaughn?
Yes, I'll miss her. I didn't know her that well.
You didn't? Nevertheless, she told me that she was so pleased to have found a neighbor she could confide in.
Confide? I'm afraid that we have to go now. Jim?
Already? I haven't had a good look at these stamps yet.
You may take them with you.
Yeah? Sort to?
Of course, you may have the whole briefcase.
For good?
I really don't think you should.
Oh, I insist. James, you haven't finished your eggnog.
We really should be going.
I'll help you carry your briefcase home.
You'll never have a case against Mrs. Marrable, so why am I wasting my time with witnesses? This is the first and the last. Go on. Come here. One, this gentleman wants to talk to you about Mrs. Marrable.
Ah, Mrs. Marrable. But why didn't you tell me? I thought it was something bad.
My land, and you trespassed. You trampled my flower bed, and you killed my pine trees. You had no right. You had no right! Who gave you the right to do this? To deprive me? Who?
alive, Mrs. Marrable. In spite of your eggnog and your fire, I've got to be grateful to Mike for that. Harriet says I got to return this, even though you gave it to me to keep. These stamps are worth a whole lot. Mr. Darrow says they're worth over $100,000.
James. Joseph Marrable. Must have hated me more than I hated him. Would you kindly drive me into town? Since I'm all alone, it seems fitting that I should apply for a position. I think I would make a most acceptable companion, don't you agree? I have savings of my own. And I have no one left in the world. After all, I'd make a very handsome pine tree.
Thank you.